Yeah, what do you know about the proof by induction then? What is induction? Induction is what? Proof by iteration. So you have a base case for that. Proof by induction means what? You have some base case, okay? And with the help of that base case, what? You can prove what an induction case is. Okay, so you can introduce. If you know that what for n is equal to 0, this is the case. So this I called it as a base case. So if I know the base case, based on that, what I can go on computing what the value for next successive n. That is what if n is 1, n is 2, n is 3, and what about n is equal to n. So proof by induction is that. Okay? So I have shown you that function, first of all, that what we have computed square of n number, okay, square of n, not square of n number is different, sorry, a square for a number n. Now, if I want to compute a square of n plus 1, okay, so how you'll compute that one? How you will compute that one? A successor, okay, for that what you required a successor and the double functions, but of course, you know the value of what your base case, and based on that what you are going to present what your induction case is. Yes, plus 2 and plus 1. Yeah, very good example with you is that what you are computing the value or sum of what the series, 0 plus 1 plus 2 plus 3, likewise. Okay, and there what you say that what it is n into n plus 1 divided by 2. This is what the value you are presenting, isn't it? So for that, what you know that what if the only zero is given to you, that the sum is what zero, okay? And the suppose two numbers are given, sum of what the numbers of or sum of two numbers. So it has been presented to you that what the first number and the second number you are doing. So similarly, if I introduced numbers, okay, they are what my induction. So what I have to do, I have to just with the help of those base case, what I'm going to repeat that sequence. And I will compute what a next successive value. That is an induction case. Yes? You got the point, I hope so. Okay. So a similar case is that what? Suppose if I took a square of a number. So simply what we are writing, a square dot n is equal to n plus n. But if you have a function, if you have to write a function, a square of n plus 1. So n plus 1 means what I have to do? Actually, how it will expand, mean how it will compute the square of that number. Of? So it is equal to what? Square of? N. Then dBl of, if I have a function, I will use that function, or otherwise what, I can go with that only. But what will happen then, what if I move it, what, n plus 2 or n plus 3, that time what will happen, that every time what, I have to change the digit then, or what? If I'm not using dBl, then what I have to do, every time what, I have to replace it by constant. So every time the definition of that value should be changed. If I do not have to do that one, if whatever the number if I provide, then what, I have to use what, the double function as it is. It is like that. Okay, so double of what? Double of n plus 1. This is what the static and the, yes. There you want to, but see, in this, when you're invoking that time what, I can say successor of n. N plus 1. But every time, whenever you're giving a call to the function, internally what it do, it will go for by proof by induction itself. How it will compute the value of n directly, suppose. You got my point or not? So whenever we are invoking any function, I'm saying that what? Compute the value of n for this. So suppose even though if I say square of n or the factorial of n, what are you going to do in that case? What do you do in factorial of n? Yeah, if you go with this Fibonacci series also, that time also what we do? You, every time what, recursively you call the function, but there what, you have a stopping criteria. Yeah. But that is different, that is what a recursive case is. Okay, now proof by induction is what you say, that is what you are starting it from the bottom up. Okay, the base condition is given. That what a proof is true for the base cases. Now using that, what you are going to do, you are trying to prove for the higher order. That is, if n is equal to something is true, okay, then what, n plus 1 will be also true for that case. This is what you are going to prove it by proof by induction. This is the case. So similar fashion, what we are saying, if square of n will give me some value, then square of n plus 1 will also give me certain kind of values. So it is like that. So that problem, what, we can solve it by a proof by induction. It is like that. Okay. So my square function will take what? An integer as a value and will return what? An integer. Yes? Multiple time I have defined that. Yes. SQ1 na hai, that I remember when you called me. Here na, SQ1. Got the point? What is missing over here? We have not given the base condition to stop. We are calling what, the function recursively. Okay, but for what value it would be true? What is the base condition for this? We have not mentioned it. Okay, so we need to mention that condition also over here. That SQ1 of what? When your n is n0 hoga, to kya hoga? Square of 0? Square of 0 kitna hoga? 0 hai? No, but square what? So some stopping criteria must be there, na? So 0, can I write 0 over here? How I'll write it? So So it would be minimum what? 1, na? You got my point or not? Okay. So if it is square dot 1 is equal to 1. So it will stop where? When it reaches to 1. Okay. Five plus one, yeah, you can. Same. Yes. So the second concept that I want to explain you that already we have seen with the head and the tail is cons operator. As I told you that what a cons operator in Gopher we are using a notation of what? Double colon. And in Haskell you can use what a notation? Single colon. Okay, this is what the difference in Haskell and in the Gopher notations. Now what the cons will do? Cons will every time. How I'll represent the array first of all using the cons operator, that is most important. Previously what we have did, we used a separate head and the tail function. Explicitly we have mentioned that go with head of this list and the tail of this list. But instead of that, what if we have the different notation which indicates that what? This is what the way a list will be represented. Means the list will be presented what? In the form of a head element and the tail element. So how I'll use it? So head, cons, tail. This will give me what? A whole list. This will give me what? A whole list. I hope you are getting it. If I have a list, L, okay, which is having what element 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So when I say x, okay, colon, over here what it would be double colon, because it's a cons operator. So x double colon, xs, xs, x and s. It's a notation. We are using it over here. So x is my head element of that list. And XS is a tail of that list. So whenever you have to extract, okay, whenever you have to extract or you have to retrieve the head element of an array, that time we will use a list in this notation or we'll represent the list in this form. You got my point or not? Previously what we did in a previous case, we executed a function product. How we wrote a function product? Product, you have used some head and in a tail form, isn't it? Okay, so similar way can I use, before that what I want to show that notation, if you are confused, then, yeah. Right now don't go with the function, we'll go with that function in detail. Yeah, it's visible. Okay, so what I, this is some zip operation, okay, and I want to pass what an array. I want to pass the two arrays. Okay, right now just consider the notation, we'll come to this function later on. So what I want, every time whenever I am recursively calling the function, what I want the head element of that array to be removed, means to be taken for the further operations. Okay, so my array, I mean to say over here, the list is represented as x cons xs. Okay, so x is nothing but what? A head element, and xs is the tail of that list. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, double colon, 2, 3, 4, okay. Similarly, if I have to represent my whole list, if I want to construct my whole list, okay, or if I retrieve each and every element of it, how it is to be? So it is a 1 double colon in a bracket 2 double colon in a bracket 3 double colon in a bracket 4 double colon. What is there? Empty list. In the end, what I will get? An empty list. You got the point or not? Every time, suppose if I iteratively, if I put a cons operator on the list, how it would be? Okay, so 1 double colon, what I will get? 2, 3, 4, 5. So x cons xs, that is nothing but what? Your tail elements. Yes? It is what? It builds what? A tree structure kind of way. So 2, okay, cons with rest of the tail element. Then what? 3 cons with 4, 5 elements. Then 4 cons with likewise. Okay, so it is what? Right-handed side skewed tree, you will get it. You will get that kind of a tree. Okay, if you read the books or maybe what on online, what you will find it out, that thing. Okay, so instead of saying that what in the previous case, head and the tail, every time what I will go now with this kind of a notations. So whenever I have to extract the first, that is an head element of a tree, list. Yes? Then we'll go with the curry and uncurry form. Okay. We'll do that one. We'll do that one only. I will take the zip as an only example. Okay. This is the built-in function I'm using. Okay. This is a built-in function zip. What is zip? When we are zipping, okay, that time what happened? The two different elements of the list, what they will, they are concatenated. It means they come together. They form a one tuple. Likewise, suppose for this zip, what I'm giving an input as in two parameter, two list element. Like suppose take an example, 1, 2, 3. This is a integer list, okay? I'm giving one as an input. And second input I will try to give is a character. Till now we have not seen the character data type. Okay, so I'll say what a character x, y, and z. Z. Okay, so zip dot. Okay. So what the output I got? 1 comma x. How it will zip the element? It will take what? The first element of the first list in tuple form. What the second first element of the second list? Likewise, what it will go on grouping or zipping what those element. Okay. So that is what you have to try. This is my next question to you. All the time, what you are one step ahead of me before I'm asking what that you are ready with those kind of questions. Okay, X, Y, Z, A, B, C. Okay, I've made what two list of type unequal size. Okay, what will happen? Now again, there is a criteria that what first list is greater than second and the second is greater than first. Then how it will be? How it will produce an output? Yeah, so whatever is a minimum length, it will take up to that. Because beyond that, what you won't go for zip. See the normal zip operation. Na? What will happen where your zip ends, there only what your that zipping process will stop. It won't go beyond that because there is no another end present. So similar thing will happen over here that when the two lists provided, they are of the unequal size, then it will consider what a minimum length of that list. There means it will do the zipping till that element. Okay. So what is an output? 1 comma x, 2 comma y, 3 comma z. Okay, and what is a data type produced? After this is what? It's nothing but a tuple of what? First element is of type integer and the second element is of type character. Okay, now this is the built-in function, zip function. How you will write your own zip function? You got the point now. How you will write your own zip function. So what you have to do, what is, see, if you want to see the type of it, type of this existing zip function, then what I will say, type of zip, what it will return me? A, the first element is what? A list A, okay, second element is, this is at some different form you have got. I will explain you that form also later on. But first of all, what? I have to give two input. Okay? That is what we call that over here, what? A domain. You are mapping it with the type. Okay? So A and B are the two lists you are input. You are giving it as an input to the zip function. And it will give you what output? A list of tuple. That is A, B, the pair of it. Pair of two elements of the list. Yes? Now suppose if I have to write the function, my own function, how I'll write it down? How I'll write it? Yes? What is the type of this function? Suppose zip1 is my own function. What is the type of this function? What it will take? Two lists it will take. Okay? A list, first list and second list of both of types. Suppose maybe integer, maybe both of them are of character, or maybe one as an integer and there is of character type. However you want to define it. Okay? And what it will returns you? It's a single list. Of course, over here also what you can... It's a single list of what? Tuple. That pair of what? Those elements. Okay? Present in both the list. So, how you will map it inside? How will write the definition, actual definition of the zip? What you want? Not various combination. What various combination you want to say? Now see. No. How I'll write my own zip function. Now, when I want to construct... You're writing for loop for I is equal to the element of first and element of second, list ka first element, that what you're going to combine. Combine is you're taking the pair of it. Data type is not important. Data type is important. You take either integer or character. I'm just giving an example to you, but I'm using an index. In my regular programming, that is in procedural or any other object-oriented form, what I will do? Object. Forget about object. Simple function. If I have to write, how I'll write? I'll take a for loop, and what first element of this list and this list, I will means I will take it together. I will make a pair of it. Then second. In the second iteration, the second element of what? First list and the second list, I will make a pair of it. Okay. Now the thing is that what? How I'll write it in a functional? In the functional programming form, how I'll do? How I'll define that as a function, my own function. So, yes, exactly. What we want to do every time. Now, what I want to? I am not able to modify the state of that variable. Okay, that what the list is being provided, what I will do every time, what I will try to extract the first element of it. But for that, what we are using, what this cons. Either you go with an head and tail functions also, no doubt. But this cons operator is the easy way to use. Means it's the same definition, means same head and tail, alternative definitions of it. Okay, so how you'll define it? So you have a base condition for it, that what if your both the list are empty, then what you will do, what will be the output of the zip? Okay, see, zip yes, if both the list are empty, okay, so this is what my base condition, and if the list has certain elements in it of different data types, then how it will do? So it will make a pair of what? X. What the notation we have used? Suppose my first array, first list, I call it as X. Second list, I'll call it as what? Y. How I'll present, how I'll notate it in the form of what? Cons operator. Using cons operator, how I'll represent it? X, colon, colon, XS. Okay, similarly, Y, colon, colon, YS. So these are what the two lists I have in this form. Okay, so zip of X colon colon XS and Y colon colon YS. This will give me what? If these are the two lists, what it will give me? X comma Y. What is X and Y over here? These are the head elements of the two lists which I have given as an input to the zip function. So X comma Y, and what I have to do? I have to append to this thing. Na? Okay? So appending in the sense what? This becomes my first pair of the new list which I am forming. So colon colon, colon colon in the sense what? Append to the tail. I mean, append this tail to the new list which I am producing as an output. So what I will do? X comma Y, okay? Colon colon. What is that next? not excess. Excess will take what? As it is excess. So I have to recursive, I have to give a recursive call. So what I will say, call the ZIF function again. And now for that, the two new, yes, the two new value, okay, of the list are what? XS and YS. You got the point or not? So what will happen recursively, what it will go on calling and it will form the list. You got the point or not? No, we are not. No, we are not changing. See. Huh. No, no, that time what it will do, it will go to the base case. And whether, wherever it found what that the list is empty, the base case is satisfied and what you will get as in zero. So it will stop over there. It will stop. Okay. So what you are giving it as an input? Suppose integer. Yes? And what the output will be? Output is in what form? I'll explain you that form also, that how I'm writing it. Okay. Okay. Or suppose you want, you don't want to be specific with the data type. Means right now what? Any data type, whatever the input if I give, okay, it should work on that data type. So I'll say what? This is what? A list. Okay, any A. Okay. I mean whatever the type I provide. And B is an under list. And then what I'll say? A comma B. Yes? Then I'll say what? Zip of will give me what? An empty list. This will give me an empty list. And what we have discussed right now, zip one of what? X colon colon XS is the notation I'm using for my first list. Okay, and my second list is of Y colon colon YS if I'm using. Okay, so what it will returns me? What it will what it will give me if what? X comma Y. Agree? Okay, then zip one of what? Over here, XS dot YS, not Y, huh? YS. Yes? Okay. What you're saying? ABC first. Okay. So int character you want. Okay. 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 Huh. It is giving me the empty brackets and the D. Mm. Okay. We already have, na? F. Yes. No, no. I mean, I am just checking it out. That what? How many? Yeah. One, two, three, four, five, six. Right. Okay. Okay. It's giving an error. Giving the two bases. Okay. Then we need to add it over here. That if one list is X colon colon empty? Will be empty, no list will provide, no? Yes, so this is what about the cons operator. Next, what we'll learn, curried and uncurried form. Okay, you already know what a unary operator and the binary operator, or the unary functions and the binary functions. Okay, unary, which will take only one as an input parameter, and binary means what? Which will take the two parameters as an input. Okay. Now, what if I give only one input, if it is a binary function, means it takes the two value as an input, but instead of that, what if I pass what? Only one parameter. So how it would be executed? If it is a binary function, okay, x comma y, or take an example like, suppose 2 plus 3, okay, in fixed form, how will write? Plus 2, 3 in prefix form. So plus 2, 3. So you will get an output 5. Okay? But if I write plus 2, I have not provided any input, second input, then what will be the value? It should be 2. How from where you got the 0? Undefined. It will throw an error. Atma the infix na yet no. काय होतं पण नाही आय वॉज ट्राईंग बट वी हियर डॉट ऑपरेटर इज नॉट बीन यूज ना इनफिक्स प्रिफिक्स नाही देते अनएक्सपेक्टेड एंड ऑफ इनपुट मीन्स व्हॉट युअर पॅरामीटर सेकंड पॅरामीटर इज मिसिंग ओव्हर हियर ओके नाउ when we are writing a binary functions, we are trying to execute those binary functions, means actually what we are converting those binary functions into a unary function form. We are mapping what their domain type, okay, to the given range type. Now, what is domain and what is range type? Function takes input, function gives you output. So input, it's your domain, and output, what you're saying, that you're mapping. So your output is, that's a range. So range of that output. So whatever the input you have given, that is a domain, that is what we've mapped with the output. Okay? So if you have a binary input or binary data for the function, that time what we will do, we will try to map it into the unary function form. Okay? And this mapping of a binary function into a unary function form is called as what? It is called a curried form, I hope so. Okay, I'll just making a mistake in that one. One minute. Give me time. Curry is this. Yeah. It's a curried form. Okay. So your curried form is what? Curried form is what? You're taking the input, okay, as a pair of what? Two input parameters, A comma B. okay, and that input, what you are mapping it or you are converting it into a unary form, okay, that is called as what? You are converting what? Your curried form into an uncurried form. So uncurried form is what? Your function will take the first A as an input and it will produce an intermediate function as an output. That intermediate function will take a Y as an input and it will produce what? Your Z or C as an output. So the mapping would be of this type. You got the point or not? Okay. Suppose, for example, a function is given to you, x plus y. A function is what? F x plus y. F of x comma y is equal to x plus y. Okay. Now, how a function would be converted into the uncurried form? Okay. So, curried form says that what? X comma y. This is what the pair all the time. What I have to produce it. Okay, A comma B, this is what an output I'm providing, x, y, and what is my actual function? X plus y. Now, when I'm providing any input to this function, say x is equal to 2 and y is equal to 5, okay, so how the function will be executed? So what it will do when it is being written in an uncurried form, that time, f of x, what is the value of f of x? It is 2. Okay, so f of x will take the value as a 2 and that function will be returning me some intermediate function, means what the function with the intermediate value, that is f of y. Okay, so what is the value of 2? That will be placed over here. So my function would be in the form of y. That is f of y is equal to 2 plus y. X plus y, okay. Now, when I have to execute f of 2 comma 5, that time how it will be? So it will take f of x and will produce what? F of y. This is what an intermediate function it has been produced. And this f of y, when I will put the value of f of y, it will give me what? A z as an output. Okay, you got the point or not? So this function is taking what? A as an input and B as an input, or you can say X and Y for the better understanding. X and Y notation as an input, and what it produced? A Z as an output. Okay, so this is what we say, uncurried form. This is what we say, uncurried form. Now, when we want to make it into the curried form, so what you have to do? That I have to just change this form into X will give you what? A representation of that some function, that is an intermediate function in the form of y, and then what it will produce the value of, that is it will produce the z. Okay, like this is what a domain, that is mapped it where? Into the z. So here what is happening? X first of all map it to the intermediate domain, and then what it is being mapped where? To the z. So that is what we are just converging, that is what is over here. This is a binary form and we are what presenting it into the unary form. So this notation is called, because every time what my function is being executed in this fashion only. So how it would be if my x plus y, if this is the real function I have designed. So if I give an input in this form 2 plus 5, so how it to be executed? Binary means how it directly what it will take the binary values. So it won't take it. So what? First of all, what it will represent that function? What? It is in the form of y. So it is 2 plus y. Okay. And when I say y of 5, then what it will represent? 2 plus 5, that is equal to 7. This would be the output produced by the whole. Okay, so this is what one way of representing the function in the gopher, or what you can say in the functional programming. If you are giving a input in a binary form, so you can convert it into the unary form or vice versa. Yes. Huh, colon T curry. So curried? Yes. A comma B, what we are doing, A comma B are separate, they are the binary. Okay, so these are curried form. And we are converting into the uncurried. Which one? For example, when you curry, what you do? You mixed everything. So there is no kind of a grouping. Every item means A, B, C. Like what? They are in a sequence. Okay? And when you do uncurry, before that what you have? Everything what in the group? Simple way of understanding. So every of you get... This is just one. This is just to make them understand that when you have in binary, that is in grouping form, when you're giving a group, means binary data as an input, so you have everything as in separate, isolated forms. And in curried form, what is happening? That you're mixing all. I mean, what you won't understand, means last element what you have to consider as that is a type. Before that, whatever will be the notations you have used, those are what all the domains. Which one? Huh. Type of, what is that? Type of curry. What is the type of curry? T is for type. Yeah. So curry is my operation. Curry means I'm making it what in the curried and uncurried form. So type of curry is what? To the domain, unclub form. Which one? Output is unclub form. So mixed all. I mean, unclubbed form, yes. Mixed, I mean to say, A, B, C, that is what in a sequence operations what you are performing. Unification is what? A curried. And when it is in a binary form, then what it is an uncurried. This is what a type of notations, okay? You can go, you can write a function either in the curried form or in the uncurried form, okay? So, means if you want to go with the curried form, you present what those input and the output in that fashion. If you want to present in the uncurried form, then what? You present the function in that notation. So, notation followed are of this type. You got my point. So curried form, what you have, A gives B gives C. I mean, A and B are the domains and the C is what your type or the range type. So likewise. And if you're going with an uncurried form, then what? Your input are in the binary form and you're presenting. So when you're defining the function definition, that time also what you have to follow this kind of a notation. Yes, unification. Yes. Now suppose we'll take a simple example. Calculate a area of a rectangle. Okay, calculate the area of a rectangle. Length is given, breadth is given to you. Yes? So what is your input? Length and breadth. Okay? And what is your output? Area. Okay? So how I'll write this function? how I'll write this function? So area colon, and if I'm giving two input, if I give two inputs, that is length and breadth. So I'll say in a bracket, rounded brackets, what L comma B. They are what my two parameters, and what it returns me? One parameter, that is nothing but what an area, that is A. Yes? So this is a binary form of representation, means writing the function type. Now, if the same function, if I have to write it into the unary form, then how I will write it down? How I'll write it? Area, okay? So you have a single colon, and then what you say? Your A is an input of, okay? Either you say a variable, you can take a variable, so there what you do not have a restrictions of a data types. But if you want to be very specific with the data type, then what you can say, int gives you int. So what, it will take two integer as an input and will produce a area, that is a output. Or otherwise you say A gives B gives C, so your A and B, or L and the breadth, length and the breadth are the inputs, and your whatever the other parameter A is what an area of that rectangle. You got the point or not? So that would be a curried and the uncurried form of representation. Okay, now see, over here, what is the ZIF function we wrote? What is the type of this ZIF function? Uncurried form, eh? Uncurried, eh? Kidhar hai? Nahi, wo nahi dekhna hai na. Output nahi dekhna hai. Input, what is the input? Input is in a binary form, na? If I have to write, yeah, if I have to write zip 1, okay, colon, and if it takes a to list, okay, you got the point or not? Yes, and then what it will produce an output as what? A single list, okay, which is nothing but what? A. So this is what? This is uncurried form. My input is in the binary form. Input, I'm giving it as an binary form, uncurried form. And how I'll make it into the curried form? So curried form says that what? Okay, zip, like what we wrote over here. That is what? A curried form. Yes? I hope you're getting it. The first one, whichever I wrote over here, this is uncurried form. Yes? What you have to do, you have to fix in your mind what is a curried and what is a uncurried. Whenever we are repeatedly using these words, it will make a confusion all the time that what is it, this is curried or this is uncurried form. Inputs are in a unary, that is an individual, one after another, what you are giving it as an input to the function. Okay? That is curried. Mix. Means mix in the sense what? All are what? They are not binded. As an, this is an input domain and this is an output domain. Which one? Which one? I wrote two over there. First one or second one? That is. This is uncurry. Whatever you want to take it. That's what I'm taking now, that when you're making curry, what you're doing, that's what I have given example to make you understand. Okay, this is curry, uncurried, uncurry hai. Before giving what tadka to your curry, what you do, you make it in the ingredients or what separated. I mean, ingredients is this and this is what my output. Okay, but when you make the curry of it, okay, so when, in a curry form what happened, all your ingredients are what? I mean, they are not mixed up, means don't go with that formal definition, but they are what, like in one by one, everything what is open. You won't understand what ki, aapko sirf ye dhyan mein rakhna hai ki last is my domain range type, and all the before that what are my domain type inputs. Where? Where? No, we are not doing. This is just a definition. No, no, here I am not changing the definition. I am writing that function in that form itself. Yes, yes, yes. No, no, no. No, 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 no. That to make you understand that what? Ki, how the type constructs are being represented in that form. You got my point or not? Okay, then when you are writing the function that time, okay, so this is what my uncurry form. So what I will take both the time, when I take it as an input, over here what I have separate, na? First list is separate, second list is separate. What I have to do, I have to make it club. I have to make it together. There what I will write, x colon colon xs comma y colon colon ys. That is as a one parameter. This indicates that what I'm passing it as a one parameter, I mean in one input itself, the set of two, but that is as in one input. For example, some area. Okay. Now how I'll compute the area of, suppose any value is given to me, L comma B, that value will be what? L into B. Sorry. Yes? Yes? Huh. Now, suppose area what is that? A. What we L Oh, it's ऑडियो जात नाही मी बोलतच नाहीये स्टेकिंग फ्लोट तो काय नव्हते आता मी इथं केलं तर रन होतं तो ओके हिअर इट्स गिव्स मी अन एरर आय नीड टू आयडेंटिफाय बिकॉज इट इज टेकिंग सेकंड पॅरामीटर एज अन फ्लोट but whereas we wrote a zip function previously which we are taking what giving a two parameter as a list it was accepting that na that is in the uncurried form only. I'll just check it out That's what I can't give the brackets. I can't give the brackets now, na? Even if I give, that would be the binary function. The definition would be called as a binary function. This giving me the output, okay? 3, 4, you're saying, na? area 1 mein nahi hai, separate hai. That's what, if, even though if I try to give in that way, it giving me an error, it is identifying 5.6 as a float value. It's taking one. But that's an, I also, I'm just trying to find it out over here, it is not there. Area 1, if, but that would be what, a two separate call. It will go as an two separate call for that function. We don't want that one. We wrote only one function. Need to check it out. Now, what do you say? This way you're saying, na? Area 1 dot... That would be another function. That it changed the definition of it, na? I'll check it out. This is this form. Int gives int gives int. I will check it out the definition. Yes. I mean confusion dur ho gaya kya? Curried and uncurried ka. Yes, it should be space separated. What was happening previously when I'm calling area 1, okay, I'm not giving a space. So what was happening over there, it is taking a 5.6. Instead of it should be a two different variable, it is accepting as a 5.6 as a one variable. Space dena hai, so you should isolate na, because wo parser kaise wo separate karega. So 5.6 as a one variable le raha tha. First dot operator, it is identifying that it is a dot operator. Okay, but 5.6, that may be a kind of float value. Okay. 30. Yes? Space. how that interpreter is, means they have functioned it, that area 1 dot. So first dot operator, it has some meaning. It's a membership, okay, dot, belongingness. So 5 of that method. But 5 ke aage bhi maine dot 6 likha hai. So it says that what 5.6 may be the possibility of 5.6, that is a float type. So the second parameter is missing, and that type is not matching with the type I have mentioned. It is of int type. So it's saying, it's giving me an error that what, it is a float type. Okay.